My name is Tom Klem, and as a boy, I fell in love with magic. I performed a little bit to the grief of my parents and my siblings, and then I put such things away and went off to college and I studied art. I became an artist and I worked in collections and also worked with the Repo History Collective, doing projects around the country about communities and the history of those communities. In around 2000, that ended, and that work went into an archive, and I worked with the Municipal Art Society on the Magic New York 9/11. And 9/11 changed me a little bit, and they asked me if I wanted to write something on magic for place matters. So I went down to the magic table and found these wonderful magicians, and I was hooked, and I was back. I wanted to talk a little bit about what is a magician? Now, my idea of a magician is probably different than Richard's idea, because Richard is actually a magician. But what a magician does, as from my point of view, is first a magician learns how to do something, whether it's with apparatus or sleight of hand. Then his job is to hide that. So if you don't see it, magician's called flashing. So that's the second thing, and once they've spent countless hours doing this, they learn how to be an entertainer and make it actually entertaining. So you see a magician, they're doing all these things. And yet all you're really seeing is the magic. You're not seeing all the work that goes into this. My notes here, one other thing I wanted to talk about was that in the bubble and outside the bubble, there is us. We're outside the bubble. And then since magicians keep these secrets, and they do magic, and these secrets, they only talk to each other about it. So there's inside the bubble. There's the magician's community, and that's what I, for the past 14 years, have been involved with. I've got some images and things up here. Some of this research, it may be a little out of focus, it may not be great, but it's to give you an idea of the various things that happened in the village in the 1990s. I'm going to start with the golden age of magic. I'm going to start back in the 1850s, when magicians were king. Before television, before TV, before movies, before radio, before gaslight, magicians were performing. And they would come into a theater, and they would perform for a month, and then Mansfield would come in and do Shakespeare. So they were on a level of the highest level of theater at the time. So let me start with, where am I starting? I'm sorry. This is John Henry Anderson, the Wizard of the North. He was born in 1814 and died in 1874. He was indeed a great magician. This is one of the coins that he was given for his command performance for Queen Victoria. He came to America in about 1849 or so. He did a trick. This is one of the things. Well, what did they do? This is one of the things that he did. He would take a bottle, a champagne bottle, and he would pour drinks out endlessly, different kinds of drinks. And there you see the young boys holding the trays full of drinks. Now this is a little less easy to see, but this is a review in 1851 from the New York Times. And it talks about his show at Astor Place Opera House. And in here, although you can't read it very well, it says, out of a champagne bottle, he poured brandy, gin, sherry, Madeira, hock, and then at the end, a hot cider. This is what the Astor Place Opera House looked like in 1851. This is from the Metropolis guidebook from 1851. And the church on the side is called the Episcopal Church of the Mediator, and it's fronting on Lafayette Place. So where the carriage is probably where Rosenthal's cube is. So this is what it looks like today. So you see the bus coming up Lafayette, a terrible shiny building in the background. And this gives you an idea of what it was like then. So now we're jumping 10 years later. He's now at the Bowery Theater. This is a New York Times advertisement. This says in there, it's very hard to read, the first appearance of Professor Anderson. And this is a broadside from the Bowery Theater from back then. Now, some of these things you may notice you can't read. It's because some of these are kind of embargoed things from archives. And I can't really allow them to be reprinted. This comes to me from the Bowery Alliance of Neighbors, David Mulkey. This is what the Bowery Theater looked like at that time. Originally known as the Bull's Head Theater, it opened October 23rd, 1825. It was the first theater to be lit by gaslight, according to what I've read, and it had 3,000 seats. He filled it for 2 months. He filled his theater with 3,000 seats for 2 months. It later had different names. Many of the theaters I'm going to show you had the name for a month, 2 months, a year. This became the Thaddeus Theater in 1879. And the Bowery Theater and variations of the Bowery Theater burnt down 6 times. Now this is across the street from the Bowery Theater. This is at 37 Bowery, and this is Signor Bartolini. He's a nice Italian magician. But now we're paying 15 cents to see this man. So this is a dime museum. I'm using this to represent the hundreds of other magicians that performed up and down the Bowery. Now, if I were to ask you, most people, you would ask, what is a magician? Name a magician.
Houdini.
90% of you would say Houdini. Now Houdini died in 1926, tomorrow on Halloween. But if I were to ask you to draw a magician, you would probably draw something like this. He's got a beard and a mustache, he's in a long coat, and there's a rat in a hat. And that's the residual memory of this man. This is Alexander Hermann. It was all those things, pulled the rabbit from the hat. And this is Hermann at the Windsor Theater, which is right next to, let's see. To go back in my notes, I'm sorry. I can't keep all of this in my head. This is the Windsor Theater. This is actually April 1883, and this is 43 Bowery. Now, both this and the Star are no longer there because they built the Manhattan Bridge and all these theaters were raised. Now, what the hell does this have to do with magic? This is a picture of the Knickerbockers, the second oldest baseball team in America. And I'm going to be talking about time in one spot. The Knickerbockers, Will Wheaton is up in the left, up in this corner here. Will Wheaton belonged to another team called the Gothams. And the Gothams met in a place called the Gotham Cottage. It was called the Gotham Inn and the Gotham Saloon. It was a farmhouse in 1777. And since its location until 1877, for 100 years. It is where Wheaton and the Gothams met in 1837 and formed the first baseball team. It's where they wrote the rules of the game and where they had several conventions. Now, the Gothams became the New York Giants, and the Knickerbockers are the Mets. We're now in the World Series. So this was here, as I said, till 1878. And then was built the new American Museum. This is not a Barnum, but rather a George Brunel's museum. And this museum, as I said, was in 1879. They had finished the L a couple of years before that. And the L would come down with a train, with an an engine, and out of it came sparks. And this broadside is from a dinner that lasted 4 months. It burnt down completely. And then in came George Milton, and he built the Globe Dime Museum. And this is 14 years later with Houdini saying in his first performance at the Globe Dime Museum, and you'll see the major Zamora there as well. Houdini claimed he never knew Zamora, but here he is on the bill with him. And so he didn't want to admit that he was able to take the sealed bottle and work his way inside it. Houdini, this is not the first appearance. He was at the Gaiety before this, but musicians tend to bend the truth a little bit. This is from the year before. This is in Houdini's handwriting, and you see the Houdini brothers performing out they're out in Chicago at the Globe Dime Museum there for Middleton. Zamora was also at the Gaiety at 138 Bowery. The Gaiety is also the first place Al Jolson ever performed. And he supposedly could get out of these chains and locks by being double jointed. Now, this is the same 1894. This is Harry Houdini, his first book, but that's what Hamlet's kind of interesting. It's that he dates it, and this is his handwriting, that was in 1894. So this is what Houdini looked at 20. He was 20 years old. He had, his father had died a couple of years before that and left his mother with six children. Houdini had to make a living, so he's out working in dime museums. He's not famous, he's making $20 a week. And this is a couple of years later, and I can tell that by the poster in the background is Metamorphosis, which is when he's now married to Bess. So in April he's at the dime museum, and in July he marries Bess. Remains married to Bess his entire life. Now, this is today. And strangely enough, there's the chef restaurant supply, and down by the load of cars you see 298. That building was built in 1878 by Edith Bristol and Fassel for $12,000. So essentially this means that this is actually the building that was the new American Museum. This was the Globe Dime Museum, it's still there. Now all of the accoutrements on the outside are not there, but the Globe Dime Museum still exists.
Okay. The Dime Museum?
Yes, the Dime Museum. Now, I mentioned that Houdini's father was a rabbi. This is from 1918, and this is Houdini set up. And Houdini is the president of it, and Al Jolson is the vice president. And if you want to join, you have to call Irving to do it. Now, all of these men started on the Bowery. That was their beginning. So the Bowery was thought of maybe as the road of lost dreams, but it was really the crucible of creativity. And a lot of great performers came out of the Bowery. Now here, this is an board map, and down on the bottom is where the Globe Dime Museum, that one red spot. And then up above that is another dot, and that is for Otto Maurer's Magical Bazaar. This is a magic store. And I'll get to my notes here, sorry. This was the front cover and also the front page, and it looks this wonderful magic store. It looks great, doesn't it? It didn't exist. His shop was down in the basement, and Henry originally Evans was there to visit and couldn't find the store. A young boy told him, go down the stairs in the cellar to find the store. And that's where the store was. And then a reporter from the Daily World also went there, and there's another reporter. That he went downstairs and found this man with dirty fingers, and he had just come from the back. Because Otto Maurer was a tinsmith first. He came to America when he was 5 years old, and he worked creating lamps out of tin for the bars. And eventually he was asked to repair magic and other things for the performers, and then he opened the store, I think in 18... Uh, 72 on the Bowery. This is what he looked like. He, let's see. He performed, he made magic, probably did the dishes, he did everything. He seemed to make juggling equipment. He performed in several different languages, and he taught in several different languages. This is Matt, doesn't look anything like him, show you with the linking rings. This is from a flyer from Go to Coney Island, and somehow he sent this flyer. And here he is dressed in either Japanese or Chinese, I'm not quite sure, because it's not authentic, from his catalog, showing the jumping equipment that he sold as well. This is, from my collection of things, this is actually a handout, a good handout, and I know you can't read it, but what is here is reviews of him, and there he is with his side. And the other side has all the things that he did, and at the bottom it says he teaches magic in German and in English and French, and all the various things he did. And here's a close-up of the top. Because what did he actually do? What he did was, his son would play the piano, Maurer Jr., and he would perform. And somehow, in the dim light, remember we're gaslight now, not electric, the flowers, heads would appear in the flowers. And as the piano was playing, they would sing. And that would be part of heads floating around. He did, one of the things he did was he took one of these heads and floated it out into the audience. And it sang in the audience and floated back. Now, I don't know whether I believe that or not. This is what he says. Now, this is Houdini. And you'll notice on that table, there's a cone and a pistol. Now, this is from Otto's catalog. Here they're selling this item. And it's, you put a coin, you go watching it, and you fire it, and it appears in the corner of the room or on a target or somewhere else. Now you see $4, you think, well, somebody's just gonna come in and buy that. In the time of this catalog, a laborer made $9 a week. So that would be, and they work 60 hour weeks. So that would be half the week's pay. Only professional magicians were buying this. Now I showed you this before, and this is the inexhaustible bottle. This is an 1851. But now it's 40 years later. So Otto Maurer is selling, is selling the inexhaustible bottle as a trick out of the catalog. And you can see decapitation was something they thought was very interesting. We have reality TV shows now. This is what was popular in this day. Now this is from Judd, this was another magic dealer on John Street. Now here's you can read this, I know, but there's two reviews in here. One is in German and one in is English, and they're for a gun club that he performed for at the Bazaar in December of 1883. Written by the Stat, which is the German newspaper. Now, the gun club was housed at this building. This building is 12 St. Mark's Place, and still exists, he's there now. This gun club, German gun club, still meets in New Jersey somewhere, and still functions. And the staff was run by Ottendorfer. Ottendorfer donated to the city this library. I can't tell you whether it's my feeling that maybe at the Wawa, the performance was in German, and this is all part of the great German society at that time in downtown. Now, this is T. Nelson Downs. He was the King of Coins. He's a famous magician and successful before the turn of the century. So he got a job on 14th Street at the Nice Theater, and he was getting 125 a week. Houdini's getting 20. So he came down and told Otto Maurer he was getting $125. And Otto got mad at him and threw him out of the store. But he came back because, As I told you, these magicians and their secrets, they tend to have communities that form. So this shop was also a gathering place of magicians. Magicians would gather there. And at this store, Otto Maurer taught Tea House and Downs how to do the back palm. And he taught Thurston how to do the back palm, another famous magician, a large stage show. Thurston took the back palm and turned it into actually an act. He's the one of the several people. Earlier he had taught Hermann, who I showed you, the back palm. And he taught this fellow, Harry Houdini. Now this poster is from 1895. It was at the Dime Museum just the month before. This is Harry kind of pretending that he's the King of Hearts. This is obviously not the King of Hearts. But this poster was for publicity. Houdini didn't really become successful until he went to England. And then things took off. This footage that you're going to see is from the end of Houdini's life. He did this, and there's much longer this, doing slights, because Houdini always wanted to be known. This is Houdini doing the back palm. This is it. Now, I'll make this again, we'll play it. So it's a much longer film. He's doing this to show that he can do the magic. But Houdini was, in before the turn of the century, the time we're talking about, he was called Dime Museum Harry. And he always wanted to be thought as a great magician. So in the end of his life, he did this piece of film.
So how do we get back?
Hit the button on that. Great. You're not supposed to read this. This is, I often wondered why there wasn't a lot of Maurer's equipment around. Well, it turns out this fire was caused in his place and he burnt down. And you can see that he lost $4,000. $4,000 in that day was about $100,000 our day. So, you know, he recovered. This is in 1882. But unfortunately, he burned down again. And this time he's trapped on the roof with his family, and his wife leaves him, and things are not so great for Maurer. This is his obit in the New York Times. He died in 1900. We don't have a clue who this guy was because we didn't live in those times. He was revered on the Bowery. He was a real character. And it says at the bottom, his friends followed the body to the grave afterwards. Houdini always bragged that he was the last one to see Maurer alive. Now, Richard, why don't you talk about the site?
I'll hit the button. Oh. Well, what you're seeing right now is a broadside for Professor Sieden, who was a magician and a saloon keeper down in the Bowery. And he was quite influential in his way. And there's several things depicted in this that kind of will be brought back to us. Particularly this phrase, watch the professor. And some of the folks who may remember some of the old magic family, the Flossos, who were related to the Kriegers, that was a term they used. This is Potter Kreger. Once again, up the top, it says, watch the professor. It was very common back in those days for a magician, a conjurer, to be called professor. Many of them had no academic standing that would warrant them being called professor, but it was part of that whole thing of alchemists and secret knowledge. It was part of the magician's persona. Now, this gentleman, Pop Krieger, more of his advertising, he was another well-known Bowery performer, friends with Professor Sieden. One of his kids, and he had several more magicians, his daughter married a fellow by the name of Al Levinson, who was professionally known as Al Flosso. And so Pop Krieger was sort of the beginning of this dynasty of magicians. Al Flosso had a son, Jackie, and for many years they ran the famous Flosso Horn and Magic Company that was located at 304 West 34th Street, right by the old Penn Station. Here's another legendary person, Max Malini. And it's curious, through some contacts in the motion picture industry, I met a member of the Dichter family. They're famous sound mixers. And Professor Sieden was Mark and Lee Dichter's grandfather. And so there's family lore about how their grandfather, Professor Sieden, was the mentor of this fellow, Max Malini, who amongst magicians is a legendary, wonderful performer who started out on the Bowery as basically a busker, which is more of a British term, probably seeing people performing in the street, trying to make a little money. They're not quite panhandlers. Today we see a lot of street magicians. And it's interesting, Malini has got this transition from the busking period, the mountebanks, to the more elegant era of magicians in tuxedos. Some people say that's why magicians wore tuxedos, to show that they were proper gentlemen, and you could actually invite them into your home. They weren't just people on the street. Another old friend of his, you notice down in the corner there, caricature was done by a well-known singer from the period, you might have heard, Enrico Caruso. All of these people, showbiz was different back then. It was so different. There were no movies, there was no TV. Do you have anything else in this secret? Oh, here's another piece of Malini. Now, as time went by, Malini worked his way up from working in the saloon like Professor Sieden had, and there were other performers down there, like famous Jarrow, who also had been a strong man in the style of Eugene Sandow, a very famous strong man who was actually Florence Ziegfeld's first big attraction before he got to promoting the American woman. But Malini, by this point, as you can see, he performed for Theodore Roosevelt, different crown heads, and he traveled all around the world, staying at the finest hotels, hobnobbing with wealthy manufacturers and statesmen, all sorts of people. As you can see, by this point, very elegant fellow, and yet he had a kind of very homely performance style. A lot of New York vernacular. He had kind of a Brooklyn accent, and it was a little bit coarse, but very charming.
So I think we should...
Well, you know what? Let me just... So this is Malini. As I mentioned, there were other people who came up with him, like this fellow Jared, who had been a strong man. And I'm going to just try and do something just for a moment, if I possibly can. Well, let's put this down. To help, just grab a lemon. Just grab a lemon. Hold on to that. And Tom, is there a plastic bag over there? Yeah, on the table. Right to the right. Yeah, hold on to the lemon. I would want you to just, what's your name, ma'am?
Karen.
Karen. I want you to hold on to the lemon, and I want you to put it into the plastic bag so we know that it's not tampered with. Keeps it fresh, too. Excellent. Now, let's see. Moving right along with this, and I'll explain what we're up to in a little bit. Well, I think we'll try this. Rather than hold something, I need money. $1, $5. The bigger the better. 10, 20, so I got a $20 bill? $20 bill?
20, sure.
20, let's figure it out. Okay, maybe we'll take more, we'll take the collection. We'll use this one, all right? And you know what, just to make sure we've got this here. We just get the serial number. You know, every bill has a little sort of fingerprint to it. Sandra. Okay, so Sandra lent us the money. And we need one more person to participate. Anybody work in the banking business? We need somebody to sort of be our cashiers. It was a little downtown theater. Or someone, let's see, Sandra's there. Who can we trust? Oh, Sandra, it's your money. You know what, Sandra, hold on to it then. Yeah, hold on to it. Got the number there, but, oh, you know what, let me seal it. I don't tamper with it. And I must give you something else to use, because in the old days, people would do things like with eggs and candle things. This is kind of an old term, but can you see the bill inside there, Sandra?
Yes.
Because what I'm going to do is attempt something that was popularized a long time ago by one of Malini's good friends, a fellow by the name of Jarrow. Now, let's recap what we've done here. Sandra's got, and by the way, what's your name again?
Karen.
Karen. Let's recap. Karen selected a lemon before we started. Then we got some money from Sandra that she's holding on to. She's got a LED light. Originally, we were going to do this with gaslight. Tom had this grant plan. We're going to march in with gaslight to show you the difference between today and the way the theater was presented back then. But Sandra's now got LEDs to work. We're going to use the gas. No danger of us having a problem here. But here's what we're going to do. Jarrow and Malini, too, one of the reasons they would do an effect like this is to get money. Now, what we're going to attempt to do is, Sandra, you're the banker, you're the cashier and everything. And I don't know if this is going to work because it's old, but it's a wonderful stunt, and I hope it'll work. And you may wonder why I'm standing here with this knife right now. Because if I foul up, I'll commit ritual having carry embarrassed. But, Tom, actually, you know what? Here, just get rid of these. Heads up, coming out. Heads up, coming out that way. Oh, all right, and let's see here. Hey, you've got the, would you mind stepping up here with that lemon? You've been holding on to it. Or if you, I think it would be nice if you'd stand up here with us. Do this. So Kate has selected a lemon. She's pulled a step out of here. So, turn around, make the act look big. Let's take out the lemon here. I don't really want to touch it. I'll take the bag. I can hold the plate. What I'd like you to do is take this knife and cut around the lemon. Kind of gently, going round and round with it. Oh, wait, no, right in the middle. Oh, wait. Sandra, you've got you're holding on to the money, right? It's in there, right?
Yeah.
Oh, do this as sideways like that. You're sure. You handled it, right? You hold the light? Wait. Would you double check, please, Sandra? Open it up. Let's work. Yeah, open it up. Tear it up. Yeah. Don't tear the money. Please do. What's the matter, Sandra? What is that?
I owe you $20.
Start just like that, yeah. Rotate around a little bit, yeah. Keep rolling, not all the way through. Rotate a little bit. There might be a stem or something inside. That's a little more like that. Okay. Let me hold on there. And see if you can kind of separate those a little bit. Be careful there. I've got an apple. What is that? Would you mind pulling that out? Yeah, I'll take that. Oh, it's all soggy. Tom, would you mind holding on to this, please?
Okay.
And could you double check the serial number, please? What have you got, Sandra? Written down there, were you holding the whole time?
JK43094515B.
That's it! That's wonderful! Now, as I say, this is.
I love this one.
Enjoy! Thank you so much. This is the casting of magic, which was invented in the village on the Bowery, generally attributed to Emil Jarrow. It's become a classic of magic, and Jarrow also worked his way up from busking to being a vaudeville headliner. And during the period of time when Horace Golden had companies working across the country, sawing a woman in half, Jarrow's billing on the theater was Jarrow sawing a lemon in half. And turn back over to Tom. Okay, well, tag team.
Yeah.
mechanism.
That's what goes, happens to time. Oh.
We should talk about this.
Well, this is programmed from the Greenwich Village volumes. And it started out down here in Greenwich Village, but became so popular, it wound up going uptown. And it even wound up traveling throughout the country. This particular bill, magicians tie it in, I don't know if you can see it here, but here in one of the sections down called Enlargement, Illusion by Howard Thurston. So some of these famous magicians like Howard Thurston, another famous fellow in the magic community, John Jarrett, were building props and things for these type of theatrical things, and they're particularly associated with Greenwich Village Follies. For magic nuts in the audience, another interesting thing is the Enlargement, the music was written by the songwriting team of Burt Kalmar and Harry Ruby. Playing this dancer, I'm having a blank right now. Fred Astaire played Burt Kalmar in the movie Three Little Words. And Burt Kalmar was also a vaudeville magician before he became a famous songwriter. So once again, magic in the village is linked to the Greenwich Village Follies, which is very, very popular show. Series of shows were used for many years.
Now this is the catalog from
Martinka and Company.
And you would think, you know, it says that it's at 493 6th Avenue, so it should be just a couple of blocks from here. You would think it was in the village. But the problem is that in 1925, they extended 6th Avenue, and all the street numbers were moved down. So now, that's roughly 12th Street. But, as in the bit here from Francis Martinka, you see it was actually on 29th Street, up in the theater district.
However, early on, when they first came to this country from Europe, we believe they did have a shop on Duane Street. We believe that they also manufactured some items for Otto Maurer and W.H.J. Judd and some of the other magic dealers in New York and on the East Coast. This is a very interesting fellow who we'll talk about a little more. Merton Clivet was a magician, a shadowgraphist, and later a painter.
Right? We'll go into that.
I'll talk about Clivet a little later.
Well, this is the village gate now, and tell them about the Ricciardi plan.
Well, yes, Ricciardi, the famous South American magician, had his show running at the village gate for quite some time. It's called the World Festival of Magic and Occult. When it opened in New York, it was originally at the Felt Forum at Madison Square Garden, but then they moved out to the village gate for an extended run, and my old compadre, Professor Bobby Baxter, was in that show. And we have some other things on Bobby Baxter. In many ways, he was the classic Greenwich Village magician because Bobby played at the gate with Ricciardi. Bobby played at mostly magic and Monday Night Magic, which is still running today. So Bobby had them all.
This is a review of a young fellow named Devlin performing at mostly magic, which was
Carmine Street.
Carmine. Yeah. 55 Carmine Street. From roughly 1980 to 1993. And here's the fourth year, a number of the people that performed there, and that's actually the owner, Iman, there.
Snake charm with the microphone stand.
if I told you Mar was a character, Iman was a character and a half. And this is one of the Magic magazines, a whole write-up about Iman.
See, one of the great things about Mostly Magic was it was also a place where magicians would congregate. Not only were magicians featured as the entertainment, but it was a place where the bartender was a magician, the owner was a magician. And as Tom said before, magicians like to have the company of other magicians.
And it was an audience of this size. It would seat 65 people. Mm-hmm. This is an ad from later down the 11th year, and a couple of your views. And this is a magician named Bobby Turkova performing actually in the space. And Bob does some interesting work. He performed there. He performs at the Monday Night Magic.
Excellent magician. Wonderful magician.
And occasionally he'll do a piece that he has culled from the 1800s and represented. I hesitate to tell you what it is, because then you'll see it. Mm-hmm. And it'll be telegraphed as to what it is. And this is another man that performed there, and this is my friend Bob Friedhofer. Bob is now a professor, Bob Friedhofer, and actually a professor. He's written 40 books on magic and science, and he performs around the world doing conferences on magic and science. But this time, he was the madman of magic, and he's cutting his hand in half here. Iman would also do things like take a knife and put it through his hand, and then, of course, it would be healed. Iman had a wonderful way of presenting this kind of crazy man and then presenting this delightful end to it. And he was a wonderful man.
Yes.
Here he is. He was the Magician of the Year this year. Study American Magician Honor, given once a year. And he signed this book. Who wrote this?
Well, this book was written by Charles and Regina Reynolds, who were longtime residents of Greenwich Village. Charles was one of the top Broadway magic consultants for many years. He was associated with Doug Henning, Harry Blackstone Jr., theatrical manager, big. And Charles was
quite knowledgeable about
very knowledgeable guy, good collection of stuff.
And at his house, magicians would gather in great numbers. And they also would gather at Harry Lorraine's house, who was on, I can now say, on James Street, because he doesn't live there anymore. And they would gather. So this was a great gathering place. And he would tell stories, like he said, that Jackie Flosser told him that Al Flosser was sitting there with Houdini. And his advice to Houdini was, never tell the truth.
This is another way that we hand things down to
and
one another.
Charlie is Magician of the Year.
When I was a kid, and I would go to the Flosso Horner Magic Shop, Charles would be there, and he was like top of the heap. And it's funny how, as time goes by, I'm sure you know many folks have relationships where they start out in awe and respect of someone and still have a lot of respect. And as time goes by, you become friends, become friendly, become very well acquainted. And that's sort of what happened to me with Charles, going from being a 10-year-old looking up to this fellow who was respected throughout the world to the point where we actually worked on a few projects together, and I very much always valued his friendship and that of his wife, Regina, who's still somewhat involved in magic today.
I met him at your house when you would have gatherings after a show. And he's talking about, he's illustrating magician's community, and that he's a magician gathering talking about these things. Now this is Monday Night Magic, which is on Playhouse Theater.
This is contemporary.
Contemporary. This is running now. It's the longest running magic show in New York City. And these are the partners.
Actually, one of the partners has passed away.
Yeah, we're going to mention that. Tom Robbins is one of them. Tom has a television show
right now.
On the Discovery Channel. Next to him is
Jamie and Swiss. It's written by a few theoretical books and a lot of columns for magicians.
I want to say, they're all incredibly great magicians. So whatever we say about them, know that first. And Michael Chow is kind of the linchpin of this group, and also Mike is, he's also someone that's a mover and shaker of magic. He's performing all over the country. And there's Frank Bretz, that's another part.
Well, Frank has passed away, but Frank was a great old-time performer. Where other people would produce doves, Frank would produce ducks.
and not just one.
Yes.
And then Peter Samuelson. And Peter's a little different because Peter is a great magician. But Peter comes a little bit from working with Paul's Saloon and Battle of the Mind, so it's a little bit of an artistic sense. And when he performs, that's quite evident. So I have a couple of the pictures here. This is
Theater Today.
This is what the theater looks like today.
Which is at McDougal and Minetta Lane, above the Café Wa.
And this is Michael doing one of his things, one of the tricks he does all the time, where he,
yes, he does.
One soul comes in, and one comes out of the other hand. And this is actually Peter Samuelson and what he is doing here. This is from New York Magazine. He's performing at a magic class at the Café Edison. And they were trying to get publicity to save the Café Edison. He came up and several other magicians performed there to try and get press to shame the owner into keeping the Edison where it was. And this is an article written by Jamie about his friend Todd. I hate Todd Rods. And if you read it, you'll find it's a piece that's, you know, very complimentary. And this is from the Genie magazine. Inside the bubble. Magicians have no magazines. They have several different magazines. They have their own historians. They have this whole magicians respecting magicians community. And this is one of the first reviews of Illuminate Magic, which started at the Sullivan Street Playhouse in the Fantastics Club.
There he is in person.
We're just talking.
She just appeared. So Tom was just getting to talk about the beginnings of Monday at Magic at the Sullivan Street Playhouse, which is where the Fantastics ran for many years. And this is the interior. This is actually one of his partners, Todd Robbins, getting married to the beautiful Krista. And there's this guy, what's his name? And Gillette from Penn and Teller, helping to officiate. There is a bona fide person standing behind Todd. You can barely see them because Penn is not ordained. This is inside Sullivan Street Theater. And did you have some more stuff? Oh,
this is
our friend Bobby Baxter, who we were talking about before.
You see the professor again. Professor.
Right. So this Bobby is a young man, probably about the time he was on the early Ed Sullivan show, what was that called? Talk of the Town.
Yeah. Toast of the Town.
Yeah. And Bobby was on that very early on. I mean, that's before they had videotape. And this is Bobby in his 80s. He kept working all the time.
And performed at the Village Gate.
At the Village
mostly
Gate.
Magic.
Mostly Magic. And Monday Night Magic at several of the venues that they've been in. There's Bobby working. I was his accompanist also. I've done that. So I'm not really in a Turkish bath. It's cavitated. That's piano. And that's Bobby working.
And that's pretty much what we have on Monday Night Magic. But Monday Night Magic, there is a flyer as you leave that has information on it. It's every Monday. The interesting thing about it is that I talked about gatherings of magicians. People come there and want to perform there. Big acts come and work. Joshua Jay will come and do close-up for Michael. It's a place the magicians like to go. So every Monday night, there's a different show. And there's interesting, there's someone doing manipulation, then somebody doing high comedy. It's a wonderful place. You should go there. Now we're going to go back to
Clivette. I just had a couple of notes, but Clivette is a very interesting character. He started out, he was born in Portage City, Wisconsin in 1868, went out west and started to get some notoriety as a lightning cartoonist. And then he put together an act that combined magic and juggling and shadowgraphy, which was the making of shadow plays with your hands.
He was on the Orpheum circuit.
He was big time on the Orpheum circuit.
1890 to 1900.
Right. And he had a company, the Great Clivette Company, which included his wife as the veiled prophetess. Now, this poster, here's another one. He later had another career as an artist, as actually one of the great American Impressionists in the Hellman book, who talks about Impressionism. He's the only American artist to get a chapter. The other six artists, as I recall, who received individual chapters, were Gauguin, Van Gogh, Cézanne, Matisse, and Picasso. And some of his works, do you have any of these?
Yeah, this is also a new magic book that he wrote. This is him actually in front of his place at 1 Sheridan Square.
And this was a building that he had. He conducted seances in the basement, had a curio shop, sometimes called The Whole World or the Bazaar de Junk. Upstairs, this is his studio, which was upstairs at number 1.
And next, we have an article written in one of those magic magazines by Richard Hatch, and it shows the family.
This is his family here, Clivette. That's his daughter Juanita, and this woman in the middle is Catherine Parker Chamberlain Clivette. And she's very important this evening.
So then that's a portrait. And this is one of
right,
the paintings,
someone's painting.
Painting of the sea. Now,
we'll do that.
And this is from Sheridan Square now. You can see the buildings are very similar. Now, there's one interesting thing also that his wife also did something else. She formed a little group called the Greenwich Village Society for Historic Preservation.
Oh. So, Mrs. Clivette, who was also known as the Veiled Prophetess, was very active in the community down here, and she was the founder of predecessor organization. And we contacted our friend Norm Nielsen, a wonderful magician out in Las Vegas, who owns the only known copy of the poster we showed you before. And Norm's wife, Lupe, is a wonderful artist in Chicle, I never pronounced that right, reproductions. But what we have made up as a gift to your organization, number three copy, all three copies from the $1 original of this Clivette work. And we hope that you enjoy.